appreciate it. It's my privilege and honor to introduce you to Shaka Sidnor, a dean at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville in the Division of Student Affairs. Shaka has been involved in the turmoil that surrounded the white supremacist and white nationalist movement's encroachment upon the grounds at the University of Virginia in August. The tumult that developed as a result of that case has been followed by all campuses nationwide, and student affairs divisions have all been looking to the aftermath of UVA to pick up on what lessons we might inculcate in our own education training to prevent such an occurrence from happening on our own campus. So while we truly regret what has transpired on the UVA grounds, we're grateful to professionals, brothers and sisters in the bond like Shaka, for their willingness to visit other campuses and tell us how it came about, how it transgressed, and then most importantly, in the debriefings, what they learned in an effort to try to make not just education at UVA better, but how they can help us learn from their sour experiences. Is that fair, Shaka? Thank you very much. There will be a moment or two after his presentation for the entertainment of questions. He's ready for those. And without further ado, Shaka Sidnor, a dean of the University of Virginia at Charlottesville. Thank you, Shaka.
All right, thank you. How's everybody doing today?
Good.
All right. So here's the thing. I look really professional, but I'm not terribly professional. And so the more comfortable we can make this for everyone, I really appreciate that. But I want to thank Kenneth and Dr. Katz for that introduction. I want to thank you all for welcoming me down here to MillSAPS. I'm excited to talk a little bit about the experience that we've had in Charlottesville over the last few months. It's something that's obviously been pretty central in my life, and I also, I want to be able to share the experiences that we've had and try to figure out what does it mean in the Jackson community and the MillSAPS community to make sure that something like this doesn't necessarily happen here. Just making sure that we're thinking proactively about it. And so, a little bit of overview of what we'll do today or what I'll talk about. So really I want to start with the context. So what's the context around Charlottesville? How did we get to August 11th and 12th? We'll talk a little bit about what we knew leading up to the rally, some information that was helpful for us, some of the steps that we took proactively. We're going to talk briefly about the 11th and 12th, just for a refresher. Obviously, y'all are a little bit farther away. It's a little bit farther away in time, so just want to walk back through the events of those 2 days. We'll talk about the aftermath, and then really I want to leave with some takeaways and then open leave some time open for questioning. So this is a little bit about me. So I'm originally from Spotsylvania, Virginia, so it's about 50 miles east of Charlottesville. Been born and raised there my whole life. I'm currently Assistant Dean of Students at UVA. Prior to that, my background is a mix of higher ed and the nonprofit sector, so I've worked in residence life, both at UNC Asheville, Nashville, North Carolina, and the University of Cincinnati. Between those two stints, I worked for a community development agency working primarily with youth in crisis, doing positive youth development, and then also worked in a group home setting with women who were survivors of physical or sexual assault, and also had some level of mental health diagnosis. That feeds into my role now, because in my role, I currently do general student support for all of our students at UVA, that's undergrad all the way up to professional. And then we also do larger scale crisis response and acute crisis response for students and for the university. This is my family here, just a picture of my family. I chose this picture, one, because it's one of the few nice pictures that we have. The other thing is the woman in the background taking a selfie is one of my closest colleagues, Alex Hall, who's also in the dean's office. Shelby Gibson, who's looking very intently off into the distance, that is our case manager over there. And so they're a big part of my professional life. I wanted them included. So some other notes are just things to consider with our time here. So I talk with my hands, so there's going to be a lot of this. My cadence gets kind of slow, so I'm going to push myself forward with my hands. The other thing is I like to move when I speak, but I've been asked to try to stay behind the lectern, so I might side shuffle like this, but I'm gonna try to do really well. The other thing, so at UVA, we don't have a campus. We have the grounds of the University of Virginia. They beat that into our heads once we get there. So if I say grounds, I mean campus. I'll try to bounce back and forth if I can. And then the other thing is, I want y'all to know that we'll talk about some things that may be politically charged, maybe racially charged today. I want you to know that my perspective is objective, and I just put that out there just so that y'all know I don't have any sort of agenda. I don't want it to come across that way, but I do challenge folks and welcome folks that if for some reason something comes out in the wrong way, just feel free to come up and talk to me later. I'd be more than happy to try to clarify that for y'all. This is my son. This is the one whose head you couldn't see. This is Zion. This is our six-month-old boy. He's also, I put this picture because he's in his state gear, so I thought that would be much appreciated here. But I want to start with some soft pictures because the warning I have here is just that there's going to be some graphic images throughout. And so again, take the steps that you need to for your own self-care. If you need to look away, that's fine. If you need to step aside, that's fine too. I just want to make sure that folks are just aware that that's coming and do what you need to take care of yourself. All right? So how did we get to the 11th and 12th? And so I think it's important to, before we talk about where we're going and where we are, to really know where we were coming from. And so we know a lot from the news, from things that we've read about what happened on those 2 days, but there's a larger story of what was going on in the Charlottesville community before those 2 days. So in March 2016, a Charlottesville High School student started an online petition to remove the two statues that are located in downtown Charlottesville. And so in downtown Charlottesville, we have a 20-foot statue of General Robert E. Lee. A few blocks down the street, there's another 20-foot statue of General Stonewall Jackson. This student's African-American student. This was about a year after the shootings in Charleston. A lot of conversation about race relations in the country, given the Black Lives Matter movement and a lot of the rhetoric around just racial relations in general. And this student said that these statues have no space in our community. The Vice Mayor, Wes Bellamy, found out about this petition and took that petition to City Council to say, hey, I think we really need to consider this perspective and talk about what this means for our community. And so over the next 10 to 11 months, the City Council had a number of votes, a number of open forums about what they wanted to do with these two statues. In February 2017, the City Council voted to remove the Lee and Jackson statues. That was obviously met with some support, but it was also met with a lot of opposition. And the opposition started to make that voice known, because through most of the conversations, there was a lot of favor to remove the statues. And so the individuals or the community that felt like, hey, we don't need these moved, there's a lot more here to this, you can't just whisk them away, similar to what happened in Baltimore, similar to what happened in New Orleans, they began to make those voices heard. And so they filed a petition in the courts that would limit the city from moving the statues. And in May of 2017, a judge issued an injunction that's preventing the city to remove them. Part of that is the Commonwealth of Virginia Confederate statues, Confederate symbols are considered memorials to veterans, so we can't move them. And so the legislature's trying to figure out what avenues do we have to do this. And part of this injunction was to continue to allow that discussion and allow some of that exploration into moving the statues. In May 2017, after that injunction was made, Richard Spencer, who is a UVA alum, is also an outspoken white nationalist, came and held a torchlit rally in Lee Park. And that's what this photo is here. I don't know if you can see in the background, but the statue's back there. This is a brief rally that didn't have a permit. They gathered in the night. They came with their torches. Richard Spencer spoke specifically about protecting the statue, protecting and speaking for white nationalism, and then they dispersed quickly. Part of that message was that this isn't the last that Charlottesville would hear about this matter, and it's not the last time that they would be seeing them. Also in May 2017, Jason Kessler, who was notorious for coordinating the 11th and 12th, files for a permit to hold a rally on August 12th. And when he made the request, in Lee Park, which is located downtown. And we'll talk a little bit about the significance of that later. In June 2017, the city realizes that while they're waiting on the ruling of the injunction to go away, and while they try to figure out what they could do in the courts around the statues, that they were gonna rename the park, so they renamed Lee and Jackson Park to Emancipation and Freedom Park. And then in July of 2017, as kind of a follow-up to Richard Spencer's May protest, a KKK chapter in North Carolina came to Charlottesville to protest the removal of the statue. And so this is really the precursor to everything that led up to the 11th and 12th, and it was continuing to build on each other. So it started with this impromptu rally in May, the KKK rally built on that in July, and that's leading us into what August 11th and 12th were going to look like. So some additional context. So Charlottesville has a history of racial divide, and we haven't really addressed it well as a city. Specifically, I bring up the Vinegar Hill neighborhood. The Vinegar Hill neighborhood was a primarily black neighborhood located in Charlottesville between the University of Virginia and downtown. In the 1960s, in an effort to better connect the university community and the downtown community, there was a pitch or a movement for urban renewal. And part of that urban renewal was that they were going to destroy the Vinegar Hill neighborhood temporarily. They were going to move the residents to public housing, and then ultimately, when it was redeveloped, they would allow them back into the community. I keep smacking these. And so in 1965, they raised the entire community. They moved the community into the public housing, but it sat dormant for about 15 years. They never developed it. These were 100 plus black homes. These were 30 plus black-owned businesses, including one of the most historic black churches in the community. It never recovered. The black middle class has never returned to Charlottesville in as equal amounts, and that dissonance between the black community and the white community in Charlottesville still exists today, especially for families who were born and raised in Charlottesville and were still around at the time. Additionally, the black community in Charlottesville still refers to UVA as the plantation. When I got there, I met some folks in public, you know, just grocery shopping, and they asked where I worked. I said, oh, I worked at UVA, and they're like, oh, you're up at the plantation, my brother's up there too, or my cousin's up there too. And so that's still a really palatable part of the community there, that the black community doesn't really view UVA as a space that's for them. And so again, this is part of that context that's leading into the 12th, and recognizing that everything that happened in that timeline we just went over is also happening in a space where folks are still remembering Vinegar Hill and still are viewing the university as a plantation. And then ultimately, or finally, there's the complex legacy of Thomas Jefferson, who's often remembered as the founder, a founding father of our nation, but also has a complex history with the relationship specifically with Sally Hemings and his slaves, but also recognizing that the University of Virginia has been built, maintained, and founded on enslaved labor. The university has done a lot through President Sullivan's leadership to try to reconcile some of our past history and who we want to be as a community and as a university. And part of that is trying to think through the contribution that enslaved people. And then finally, just some additional part of the context is where this conversation is happening when there's also a lot of divisive and racially charged rhetoric going on, especially in the 2016 campaign. And that's not to single out the 2016 campaign. There could be other instances that you could look at over the last 10 or 12 years that have kind of gotten us to this point. But the fact of the matter is there was a lot of this rhetoric happening, a lot of divisive language. What we're trying to, as a community, figure out how we can bring our folks together to address this issue. Nationally, we're not seeing that. The folks that we're looking to for guidance and our leadership aren't doing that. And so it results in an inability to have civic conversation and to be able to have conversation with individuals when they disagree. So leading up to the rally, so a couple of pieces here that I just want to highlight. I think the biggest challenge leading up to the rally for everyone involved in response, the university, all of our law enforcement agencies, was incomplete intelligence. And so I have a friend who says that the white supremacists of 2018 aren't the white supremacists of 1818. And by that, they just mean that, you know, there's this perception of who individuals who have this ideology, what they look like, how they present. But that's not necessarily the case. Jason Kessler is educated at UVA. Richard Spencer was educated. So these are really intelligent people who are leading some of these charges. And so when they coordinated the Unite the Right rally, they were very strategic about the way in which folks who were coming to the UTR rally were communicating. So it happened primarily on a social media app called Discord, which is a private, you have to be a member in that group. They're private messages, and unless you've been invited and been vetted to be in that group, there's no way that formal intelligence can get that information. Additionally, it was direct communication. So it was email to email, it was text message to text message. and Jason Kessler specifically asked individuals who had planned to attend the rally not to post anything about it on social media, not to talk about it unless they've known who that person is and they've been vetted either by that individual or through the organization. So it made it really difficult for us to be able to gather the intel to know where the 11 and 12 would be. Now, we used the Virginia Fusion Center, we used our normal methods of gathering information, but the challenge is there had been nothing like Charlottesville before, and also this is the first time something like this has been coordinated with this type of technology. Additionally, there's a breakdown of communication between jurisdiction and the community, and so while we're getting some of this incomplete information, it was a challenge getting that between the three different jurisdictions. So in Charlottesville, so in the Commonwealth of Virginia, cities and counties are politically separate entities. And so the city of Charlottesville has their own police department, Albemarle County has their own police department, and then we as a university have our own police department. And so one of the great things about the way in which they function day to day is that they share a central command center. But oftentimes when there's intel coming in, they have to make sure that they are on the same. And so that got a little challenging, and then also trying to include the university officials as well. And then the city was woefully underprepared for the scale of the 12. And so after the KKK rally, I believe the city thought that it was going to be something of a similar scale. So roughly 400 to 500 folks. But as more intel began to come in, as more people began to post that they were coming to the university, David Duke was very outspoken about gathering folks who identified with white nationalists or white supremacist ideologies to come to Charlottesville. They quickly realized that wasn't going to be able to be managed appropriately. The city attempted to move the rally from Lee Park to McGuffey Park, which is a larger park, not so central to downtown. That would be a little bit easier to manage. But after they've already approved the permit, once they tried to move it, it started to impede on First Amendment rights. So Jason Kessler took the city to court, won his appeal to keep it in Lee Park, and ultimately that's why it stayed downtown. And then finally, this is also a very emotional thing. There are a lot of folks that are part of this conversation that when they think about removing the statues, it is challenging their Southern heritage. It's challenging a part of their history. There are a lot of people around Central Virginia who can track their history back to the Civil War, back to Confederate soldiers, back to Confederate generals. And so we needed to recognize that there was a lot of emotion there, and I think we did to some degree, but not fully. And then obviously there were frustrations with the socio-political climate, and then the KKK and white nationalist rallies from earlier in the year, there was still a lot of anger and frustration around the fact that they happened, and also how they responded to it and handled it. The other thing that the community tried to do, the university and the community at large, was counter-programming. So we had our faith communities came together and held a number of interfaith services before the 11th and 12th, including the morning of the 11th and the morning of the 12th. So these are our churches, these are our temples, some of our Unitarian churches, coming together to say, we need to come together as a community and figure out how we can face this evil and challenge this evil. The university community also offered counter-programming, so the African American Cultural Center, or Heritage Center in town, had a full day of programming where they tried to encourage community members to come to, stay out of downtown, don't be a part of that. The university also had a number of events, conversations, panels on grounds that would ultimately draw attention away from there. And then the university, the state, and the city also encouraged members of the community not to go downtown. And that was met with some resistance because there's a large activist community in Charlottesville that felt as if we weren't down there, if folks weren't down there, then they weren't challenging these ideas and they were really permitting them to go to stay here. And so that was a sticky position for a lot of folks to be in, to be told not to go down there when they felt they had the right to exercise what they felt was also their free speech. And so then that brings us to the evening of the 11th. And so on UVA's central grounds, the night of the 11th, around 300 Unite the Right protesters marched from Nameless Field to the rotunda wielding these lit torches. And so the challenge, well, sorry, excuse me, so wielding lit torches. Some of the chants that they were yelling as they were going through the hardware campus was, "White Lives Matter. Jews will not replace us," and then invoking the Nazis with blood and soil. Part of the challenge with the march on the 11th was, again, because the intel was incomplete, when There was a plan in place. The Unite the Right organizer had been communicating with Charlottesville Police Department and the University of Virginia Police Department, and they had a plan in place. The march was supposed to begin at 10 a.m. They were going to walk through, walk from Nicholas Field onto Central Grounds. But one of the challenges was they said to a Jefferson statue. Now, we love Thomas Jefferson at UVA. I probably passed 15 or so Thomas Jefferson statues or busts on grounds every day I go into work. And so it was really difficult for law enforcement to have an appropriate response because they didn't necessarily know where it was going to go. And so when they tried one last call before the march was to begin around 9:45 to say, hey, just want to follow up, make sure we know what's going on so that we can be there to protect everyone. The Unite the Right organizer hung up the phone very quickly, said I can't talk, and then obviously what ensued was a bit of chaos because we didn't know exactly where they were going to be. So unfortunately, these 300 protesters circle a group of counter-protesters that are at the statue. And so, again, Charlottesville has a very active activist community. And so a group of students, a group of community members who wanted to counter-protest came to the Jefferson statue, locked arms, and stood around the base of the statue. And we're just singing songs, specifically Negro spirituals, in an effort of solidarity. These students were then circled by these individuals with their torches, and because UPD had incomplete information, by the time they got there, they were standing on the periphery of this. And so they were monitoring it, and because we're a public institution, we were really limited in how we thought we could respond. There's some confusion about our open burn policy and our open flame policy that also made it difficult for law enforcement to respond until after it already turned violent. And so some tensions rose, and then there started to be fights, mace was sprayed, people started swinging torches, and then UPD was able to come in, they called for CP backup to break it up and declare it an unlawful assembly. it was handled relatively quickly, and luckily there wasn't a lot of folks who were injured, there weren't a lot of arrests, but this really set the tone for how the 12th was going to escalate. And so then that brings us to the 12th in downtown. And so the Unite the Right protest was supposed to begin downtown in Lee Park at noon. And Unite the Right protesters and counter-protesters started to come into the community, started to come downtown to the park around 8:30. I would encourage y'all, if you want to know more about the specifics of the law enforcement response, specifics of the city response, there are a lot of reports out there, there are a lot of summaries of those reports. I'd encourage you to read those. I'm not going to focus too much on that today. But what I will say is that there were some challenges to having folks show up so early. There was also some challenges and some faults within the preparation plan that unfortunately resulted in the two groups coming together sooner than anticipated and having some of this violence break out earlier. And so the protesters and counter-protesters, they start engaging with one another. And it turns ugly pretty quickly. They begin throwing rocks. They throw balloons full of urine, balloons full of feces, other objects, bottles that have paint in it, just a litany of just really nasty things that are going on. It continues to escalate throughout the day. And so folks are getting in at 8:30, about 2.5 hours pass, and finally a state of emergency is declared in the city. And so that happens at 11:08 a.m. At 11:31 a.m., an unlawful assembly is declared by the police. And then at 12:06 p.m., the governor issues a state of emergency. And so what that means now is that we have these two groups that are now, these two or more groups that have already been violent over 3 hours. And now, because there's an unlawful assembly, they're now being pushed out of the park, but into the community where there is no police force, because the police force is in the park. There is no National Guard because they've been shifted around and kind of resituated in the city. And so these folks are being forced out of this and right into one another. This picture here is a perfect juxtaposition because it shows a group of the counter-protesters and a group of the Unite the Right protesters coming together. And this is indicative and a clear reality of what was really happening after the state of emergency was declared. So these two groups are trying to get out of the city, they're trying to get out of that space, but they're still confronting one another. And the violence continues to escalate. The gentleman with his head bloodied is DeAndre Harris, who was recently in court about what happened on the 11th and 12th. to the top to the right is a group of counter-protesters, but specifically a group that is identified as Antifa, who are present there. And then in the bottom picture here, you can see that these individuals are fighting, someone is being beaten. This was happening all across downtown. And at this point, because they were still trying to disperse the thousands of people out of the park and away from that area, law enforcement wasn't able to respond to everything that was occurring. And so this is a lot of what was happening. The violence continued to escalate until finally folks started to disperse. A lot of the white nationalist groups went to McIntyre Park, where there was going to be a supplement or a follow-up rally. David Duke, Jason Kessler, Richard Spencer also headed to McIntyre and asked their groups to follow them. And as they started to disperse, the counter-protesters also started to leave. And so this is probably the most telling visual from the 11-12. But at 1:41 p.m., James Field drives his vehicle into a crowd of counter-protesters, injuring 30 and killing Heather Heyer. It's a really powerful image, because I think what's lost in all this is the complexity. It's the fact that there's these two ideas that we're talking about, right? Inclusion and diversity, and then an idea that is exclusive, an idea that is about supremacy, about nationalism, about other individuals. But one of the things that we need to realize is that these are lives that are being impacted in this situation. There are lives that are lost, and there's lives that are changed forever. And so, given all that, the aftermath started with a lot of finger pointing and blame. And so, when people are emotional, when people are mad, when people are dueling ideologically, there's a lot of finger pointing. You could see it on the news, you could see it in town, at the university. People are pointing and saying, this is your fault, this is their fault. Why didn't you do this? Why didn't you do that? They should have been better about this. Why didn't we force them to move? Why do we have to give these individuals freedom of speech? Why do we have to let these individuals come to grounds? There was a lot of that type of rhetoric happening in the immediate aftermath. We also had a very fractured local government until recently. So this is a photo of our city council meeting. This is pretty indicative of our city council meetings for the next 4 months until we had a new election, had a new mayor elected, and had new city councilors. There was frequent disruption. City council wasn't really able to get a lot of things done. There were arrests and people escorted out of the city council meetings. City council meetings that were running until 11:30 midnight because there were individuals who were sharing frustrations and their opinions. It was a really difficult time to think about politics after an already exhausting time. There was a lack of trust in law enforcement agencies. The city police chief came under fire, the university police chief came under fire, Virginia State Police and their response came under fire, and there was a lack of trust amongst all of the community, white, black, student, students, townies. There was a lack of distrust for all law enforcement agencies and a lack of trust in the university. The university put out several messages, one after the 11th, one after the 12th, and it was really challenging because President Sullivan really tried to address what she believed was the mission and the values that we stood for the university and speaking out against the Unite the Right protesters. But there were a lot of individuals who were mad that she didn't call out the counter protesters. There were individuals that view Black Lives Matter, that view Antifa, or individuals that don't, that have a different perspective than the Unite the Right group, as also being militant, as also being terrorist groups. And so that was a really challenging place to be because we're fractured already, there's a lot of blame going on, and then even when we try to respond to it, that's falling flat and not falling well. And then the hot takes, and I talked to the student life group about this yesterday. I think that was even the most frustrating part, was hearing the media, hearing individuals who weren't in Charlottesville talking about what was going on in Charlottesville, someone who was in California, whose aunt's sister's brother went to UVA in the 70s, talking about what Charlottesville was supposed to be. I know that sounds ridiculous, but that's really the kinds of things that were happening, whether it was online, whether it was on a major news network, local news network. It was really difficult to get out in front of the story because everyone was already telling their own story. A lot of it wasn't really factual because those of us in the community were still trying to figure out what was going on. So how could individuals who weren't in the community know what was going on? So that makes it challenging to try to respond appropriately. and try to respond in a timely manner. And so it took a lot of this messiness. It took us seeing all this before someone kind of said, what's the purpose of this? Where should we be? Blaming one another isn't helpful. Not trusting law enforcement is not helpful. Critiquing the good faith efforts to address what's going on isn't helpful. And so how can we get to a place of care? And so we started asking these questions. How are we caring for ourselves about this? There's a lot going on. What are we doing as a university, as individuals, as community members, as a city? How are we doing this? How are we caring for ourselves? How are we caring for our students? And this is an interesting question because this happens about 2 weeks before our students move back to the university to begin the fall semester. So how do we care for first-year students who are coming to Charlottesville and don't have any connection with what's going on? They're excited about coming to UVA for the first time, and then this is what they're seeing 2 weeks before they get there. How are we caring for folks who are second years, third years, fourth years, who are looking forward to coming back and having their continuing their college education or finishing out their college education, this place that they've come to know and love, but then this is what they're seeing and not necessarily feeling safe. How do we care for our students of color who are seeing this on TV and they're like, man, this makes me really uncomfortable to come back. And a voice that I think was often lost in this is, you know, how are we caring for our Jewish students? We have a pretty significant Jewish student population. And while there were a lot of white nationalists, part of white nationalism, part of white supremacy, some of that ideology, is also very anti-Semitic. And so what were we doing to support our Jewish students? And knowing that primarily Charlottesville is a very black, white community. But we need to think through those things. And then how are we caring for our community? As an institution, what are our town and gown relationships like? But then also as someone who lives there, who's raising a biracial family in this city, what does it mean to care for our community and say, this is the place that I live, this is where I'm raising two of my boys, this is where I work every day, this is where I worship. What does it mean to care for this community knowing that we're hurting right now? And then after you're thinking about that, also who needs support and where are they gonna get it? Because I know in the immediate aftermath, I was in no state of mind, I was still processing myself, I was like, I don't really know if I can support these folks when they come back in 2 weeks. The woman up here is a UVA student. So the woman who's bleeding from her head, she was here early for the summer. She decided to go downtown and voice her opinion and stand up against what she believes are beliefs, or what she believes in ideology and philosophy that is not indicative of our community, not indicative of our institution. She was one of the individuals who was hit by the car. And I think it took a sobering moment like that for us to sit here and say, we don't have time to point fingers, we don't have time to blame, because there's people who are out there hurting. We need to figure out how this young woman is gonna seek the medical attention she needs, how is she gonna be able to continue as a student here, how is she doing as a person, what are her thoughts, how is she navigating this as an out-of-state student and trying to make sense of the world, and realizing that's where we need to focus our time and our attention and shifting. I feel like it was once we started getting there, once we started asking those questions, once we started thinking that way, that we could start to move forward. And so, from the university's perspective, one of the things that we did, again, so the president quickly condemned the UTR protesters. Again, it was met with mixed reviews, talking too fast. But then she quickly established a dean's working group to review the university's overall response, but specifically to prioritize looking at our space use, open flame, and free speech policies. As a public institution, any open space in public space is open to the public. We are the flagship institution of the Commonwealth of Virginia, so therefore we are there for the people of the Commonwealth of Virginia. But what did we need to do to say, okay, we still want this to be a space that everyone can use, but how can we do it in a way that's gonna mitigate something like this from happening again, from having our students who are on grounds at their school standing up against something that they believe, how are we gonna keep them from being encircled again, being threatened again, feeling as if they're being intimidated? Student affairs, we had some time to plan before students came, but then also for the students that were around in the immediate aftermath, we started to offer programs. So some of those programs that were offered on the 11th and 12th because of the state of emergency, we had to cancel those. And so we reshifted those. We shifted some of them back to when students were coming back to grounds. Our Multicultural Student Center, they made their staff available and open their offices beyond normal business hours just so that students can come and sit down, dialogue, process everything that was going on. Because one of the things that we realized was we need to care for one another. We need to make sure that we have the space to do that. Part of my direct response was engaging with alumni, parents, and prospective students. Our Dean of Students is great at thinking through appropriate response and making sure that our team is available for response. So when we came back to work, the next day we were really kind of locked in and we were just there answering phones. And whether it was an alumni who was frustrated with President Sullivan's message, whether it was Sally Jo from New York who saw something on the news that she didn't agree with, we were answering the phones, we were talking to them, we were responding accordingly, and to the best of our abilities, helping people understand what we were doing to make the university a safer place, what we were doing to support our students, and then for prospective students and parents, what we were doing to make sure that when their student got there, whether it be in that fall, whether it's in a year from now, whether it's 2 years from now, what are we doing to make sure that this can't happen again? Now, obviously, we can do a lot of things. There's nothing that I can say 100% that's like, this will never happen again. But what I could do is say, these are the steps we're taking. This is how we're reviewing our policies. This is how we're thinking proactively about response in the future so we can mitigate that. And sometimes that was really great for folks. Sometimes, you know, they called me everything that a child got and hung up. And that's okay, because that's all I can really do. But I think the most powerful part of all this was the students. And when they came, the students that were there in the summer, the students that came back in the fall, kind of coming back, coalescing, and saying that we are going to reclaim our grounds. And we want folks to know that this isn't what Charlottesville is. It's not perfect, but this isn't what it is. This isn't what our university is. This isn't what we stand for. And really, really working with administrators, working with one another to offer programs, to offer panel discussions, to offer opportunities to rebuff some of that narrative that was out there. Letting people know, like, hey, yeah, this was really tough, and we just went through this, but we're not just going to sit on our laurels and let this continue to be what it is. We're going to redefine what Charlottesville is and who we are as the university. And that was great, because that allowed us to continue to focus on some of the outward-facing response, knowing that our students were really, really focused on the student engagement piece and the student response. In the city, admittedly, the process has taken a bit longer. Like I said, the city government was very fractured from August until late November, and that made for a lot of tense conversations. It made for a lot of stagnant progress, and it continued to build distrust with our city government. We had an election in November 2017. We have a new mayor. We have some new counselors. Our police chief has since resigned in the aftermath of everything that happened in August. And so I think the city is now at a point where they're asking the questions about care and saying, hey, and this is my personal opinion, but saying we've kind of dropped the ball on this. We've been acting irresponsible. We haven't been putting forth great leadership these last few months. Let's start doing that. And I think the city has been, since November, has started to take some really great steps. A lot of the healing efforts started with our faith community, so similar to how some of the programming did in the before the rally. It's been really great to see some of our churches, some of our temples, some of our some of our other faith communities come together and really start some of this interfaith dialogue. And I think the city is now following suit and seeing the value in bringing folks together to talk about difficult things. But we're still trying to consider what to do with the statues. A new court ruling just came, so after we could move them, the city voted to shroud them, so they put what we call mourning shrouds over them, M-O-U-R, and so they were covered in black shrouds for the last 6 months. A court recently ruled that we have to take those down, and because they are statues to veterans, and because we're charged with protecting them, that we have to do everything, that the city has to do everything that they can to protect them and make sure that they're not defaced. So it's a new challenge that we're going to have to face. It's a new challenge that the city is going to have to face, and I'm encouraged by what I've seen in the last few months, and hoping that something really positive is going to come out of that. And then the city's also working to recognize the memories of the three lives lost that day. So Heather Hiram was killed by James Fields, but then also the two Virginia State police officers whose helicopter, they were monitoring the situation, their helicopter crashed. And so we've been thinking actively about how to recognize those individuals. This is a photo I took. My mom and I do lunch once a month. I'm just putting that plug out there in case y'all see your moms enough. Moms love us, so go see your mom. But me and mom do lunch once a month. And so we walk downtown. This is 2 weeks after the 12th. And this is Fourth Street, which is downtown. It's where the car came. You can still see the flowers there. I thought this image was a very powerful image. But Fourth Street is now known as Heather Heyer Way. And it's a really small token, it's a really small way to honor her legacy. But one of the things that we as a community don't want to come out of this is this idea that we're scared. Is the idea that these folks can come to our community, they can wreak the type of havoc and the type of violence and spew the kind of hatred that they did, and think that we are going to be impacted by that in a way that we're going to live in fear. And so we're trying to remember these individuals' legacies. We're trying to tell their stories as well, knowing that their lives weren't lost, that they weren't lost in vain, and ultimately they were lost in a way that was trying to make Charlottesville a better place. So moving forward, I want to talk about some of the positive things that have happened, right? So we've had all this go on. What have we learned? And so some of the things that we've done, we've increased our UPD and our ambassador's presence around the grounds. And part of that was we started that right in August to make sure that there was a sense of security. But we've kept that up because we know that some folks still aren't feeling safe. They're still not feeling comfortable in their community. And so we want to make sure that that we have that presence around, that everyone who comes to the university, is at the university, or is engaged with the university, feels safe. We've established two pan-university committees to review space use policies and open flame policies to better enable our law enforcement partners to respond. So again, I think very highly of our law enforcement. I work with the UPD every day. They're great. But the challenge is, when you don't have all the information, you're not going to be able to respond in the best way possible. You're not going to be able to do your response isn't going to be the best that it can be. And so part of that was, there was some confusion about our policies. Our law enforcement agencies didn't know, can you have an open flame on the lawn? Can you bring torches to the lawn? And a part of that was, our policies were ambiguous. And so our general counsel, along with some of our folks in the dean's office, have started to review, what does this look like? You know, how can we make this more clear? So our law enforcement knows what it is, but also so our university community knows what it is. So if they see something going on, that they can address it. But also leaving space for those other communities, such as candlelight vigils, or if there was ever any other community event where we wanted to use an open flame, you know, torch-bearing ceremonies, things like that. There we go. So we started to review those. We reclassified the lawn, which is the central part of the university. So if anyone knows anything about UVA, Thomas Jefferson built the original lawn rooms and the rotunda to kind of face inward into this great green space. We've reclassified it as a facility, which limits the ability to have an open flame, but also have open carry. So again, UVA, it's public space. In the Commonwealth of Virginia, you can open carry. And so there's nothing permitting individuals from coming to grounds with firearms on the lawn until we adjusted this policy, which I think is really great. We strengthened our open burn flame policies. We're still going through it, but we're working on that and intensifying the way it's enforced. And then reviewing our policies on protest and free speech. I think one of the things you'll hear over and over about Charlottesville, tied to Charlottesville, is Charlottesville and the First Amendment. What does free speech look like? What's hate speech? What's time, place, and manner? I haven't talked as much about the First Amendment in the first 29 years of my life as I did before August. And I've learned a lot. But we're in this unique position where, as a public institution, we have to make sure that we're allowing individuals, regardless of what their ideology is, regardless of their philosophy, to come to grounds and be able to exercise their right to free speech. And so we're just trying to think about, how can we do that in a way that will still limit something like this occurring. And then engaging the broader community, conversations when possible. So again, the town and gown relationships. We have a complicated relationship with Charlottesville, and I think we are trying our best to make sure that we're getting into the community, talking with folks who've been impacted, and also thinking how we can work together to move forward. And then our law enforcement agencies are continuing to collaborate to try to figure out, how can we improve on the way, not just that we respond to incidents, but also that how we gather information. and so, thinking about moving forward, when Britt reached out to me and asked, Dr. Katz reached out to me and asked to do this presentation, one of the things I thought about was, okay, what are the lessons that we learned from Charlottesville? And so, I can walk through those things. I walked through some really concrete But there's also some guidance, some advice that I was ruminating on, thinking on about what would it mean, what do I want to leave the OSAPS community with? And so these are some of them. So one, Charlottesville didn't have a Charlottesville. So there was no precedent for this. We didn't have any way to anticipate that this was going to happen or that it was going to look like the way it did. And that was really challenging for us. The benefit is Millsaps has a Charlottesville. Jackson has a Charlottesville. And so as conversations come up in your community, as conversations come up on your campus, if for whatever reason individuals wanted to come and exercise this type of speech or this type of protest on your campus, recognize that you have something to look back to say, hey, that was really challenging for UVA and for Charlottesville, but what are the steps that we can take to make sure that that's not going to be the case here? What are the steps that we can take to let folks know? Sure, we may welcome you here to talk about this, but this is not what being a Millsap major is about. We don't stand for this. These aren't the kinds of things that we stand for and that we welcome here. And so that's what I want for y'all to know is that we didn't have that, but y'all do. And so I hope that y'all are able to look at what happened in Charlottesville and use that as a springboard for making progress. The other thing is, I challenge y'all to have difficult conversations, period. I know it says and, but I'm gonna put a period there when I'm speaking. Have difficult conversations. That, when we were pointing fingers, when we were blaming one another, that was stemming from, we didn't really wanna talk about what happened. We didn't really want to talk about, instead of saying, hey, they didn't do that, what didn't I do? How am I culpable for this? What is the role that I play in this, and how can I improve to make my community better? So I challenge y'all to have difficult conversations. And when you have difficult conversations, listen to what's being said, and don't necessarily listen to respond. Because the other lost part was, we were hearing all these different perspectives. Wow, 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 this is what's going on. And what people were doing, they were ready to be on the defensive. Oh, well, Charlottesville's a really welcoming and inclusive place. But if you're a marginalized individual in the community, well, no, it's not. But we know we took the time to say, well, help. Maybe I need to listen to this and kind of think through that and try to understand, why do you think it's so great, and why do I think it's not? Why do I think this response was really good, and why do I think this one wasn't? We don't listen. We don't have conversations to listen anymore. And when we started to move forward, it was when people started to say, I need to shut up and hear what someone else is saying. So I challenge y'all to have those conversations and listen, to really hear what folks are saying and not just to respond. But with that, know that progress is really, really slow. I don't know what it's like in Millsaps. I love UVA, but progress is really, really slow because we're big. There's a lot of perspectives there, and we have to have a lot of difficult conversations. And we may have to have them a lot of times. We may make some progress, you know, one step forward, two steps back, but knowing that working towards progress is where we need to be, it's gonna take time. And so we have to be ready for that. We have to position ourselves for that, and knowing that this isn't gonna change overnight. And especially when there's deep wounds, it's easy to come in and say, Charlottesville, as a city, we need to do better with race relations, that the Black community feels marginalized in Charlottesville. It's easy to say, okay, well, let's fix it. But when you think about what happened in Vinegar Hill, if you think about the fact that 53 years later that we're still, that the Black community is still not where, as prosperous as they were then, that there's not as many Black, the Black businesses haven't recovered in the same way, that the Black middle class has not recovered in the same way, that's really difficult to just kind of glaze over. And so it takes a lot of time. Don't be afraid to be wrong. And so when you open yourself up to conversations, when you have difficult conversation, there's going to be a good amount of vulnerability. And in some of that vulnerability, you might say something that's not that tactful, or you might say the wrong thing, or you might not know the words to say. And that's okay. I think we're at a point in time where folks in leadership or folks that want to present a certain way are like, I don't want to be wrong because being wrong means that I'm less than, or being wrong means that I don't know. And that's true, we're all imperfect. But I think if we're open to being wrong, if we're open to have that vulnerability, that's when we start to see some real progress. Engage as a community. So again, hindsight's 2020. If, you know, I think if we were having a lot of these conversations in the community early on, the 11th and 12th might have looked a bit differently. But again, we didn't have a Charlottesville. what y'all do, as y'all are having conversations, engage with the city, engage with the other institutions in the community, find out, have y'all talked about this? How have y'all talked about it? What have been things that have worked for you? You might find that something's been going on and figure out like, oh, that's something that I want to be a part of. Or there may be nothing going on and you may say, hey, let's start something. Let's have some conversation. I think the more folks that can be on the same page that are doing, that are thinking critically about where they are in a space, how they're responding in a space, and how they're trying to make a community better, is going to be best for setting folks up for success. And then finally, my last thought here. So I listen to a lot of hip hop. And so this quote, is actually a song, Be Better Than Me. I put Clifford Harris Jr. because it sounds more formal and fancy, but it's actually, his stage name is T.I., so if y'all know the rapper T.I. He's one of my favorite artists. And when I was thinking about how I wanted to end this time with y'all today, I was trying to think of what was a good way to wrap this up. And I tried to think of a more appropriate, less obscene, or not obscene, but less explicit song. But I really resonated with this, right? Because what we experienced was really ugly. And so what the song is about is T.I. is talking to the listener. So T.I. grew up in Atlanta, in inner city Atlanta, in the Bowen Homes Projects. And in this song, he's talking about his experience as a young man growing up in the projects and talking about the things that he's experienced, the things that he's seen. And he's addressing the listener as if they are, they're in a similar situation. And what he's saying is, hey, this is what I've gone through. And it was really, really bad. And it was really rough. But that's my story. And the refrain before the hook is he says, short of the streets ain't the place for me. It's too, I lost my quote. Short of the streets ain't the place to be. I'm telling you because it's too late for me. And it's this idea that this was my experience. I don't want this experience for you, and I want you to be better than me. Jackson Millsaps, I don't want y'all to have a Charlottesville. I don't want y'all to go through the 11th and 12th again. I want y'all to be able to look at what occurred. I want you to think about the things that happened and think, what can we do to be better than Charlottesville? What can we do to be better than the University of Virginia? And that's not saying that in a pejorative way. That's not saying that we were terrible. We just didn't know what we didn't know. But I challenge y'all, I encourage y'all to think about the things that you do know now, to have difficult conversations, to think about what is Millsap's place here in this time when we're having these conversations. When we think about the shooting that happened the other day in Sacramento, and some of the conversations that are going on around police shootings, and as we're talking about, continuing to talk about race relations in a socio-political climate where folks aren't having positive conversations, where they're not having constructive conversations. How can y'all be at the forefront of having those conversations? What are the steps that y'all can take to be ahead of the game? And what are the steps that y'all can take to be better than us? I appreciate y'all's time. Thanks for having me today. And I think we're gonna open up to some questions.
Yes, time for questions, please.
And let me just say, we've got about 5 minutes of questions, but there's gonna be a reception that immediately follows our time together. So if you don't get your question in, we're gonna gather the first floor lobby of the AC for coffee and for the conversation. So thanks, Dr.
First of all, thanks for coming. Yeah. For the courage and shift to have this kind of outreach effort. The thing that struck me most strongly about your last slide is don't be afraid to be wrong. Mm-hmm. Being wrong in these kind of situations has serious implications for yourself, for your institution. Help me understand what you really mean there.
Sure. I'll use the situation we have with our law enforcement as an example. So on the night of the 11th, as it was clear that the intel was incomplete or it was flawed in some ways, Charlottesville Police Department reached out to UPD for assistance and said, "Hey, we know that the intel isn't exactly clear here. Do you all need assistance?" Now, I'm not in Chief Gibson's office. I don't know exactly what those conversations were, but repeatedly UPD said, "No, we don't need your assistance." And you know, a lot of the a lot of the speculation, and I'll say this is me as an individual saying that, you know, part of my speculation was that the idea was we got this, we're okay. Like, we don't need help, we've looked at everything, and we're okay. But, you know, and maybe even if they had CPDs, it still may not have made a difference. I believe that it would have made a difference. But I think in those situations, when you don't know what's going on, and when you're already unsure of what you think you know, it's okay to be like, you know what, I might be wrong on this. Let me reach out for support, and maybe that's a different way or a better way to say it. But you know, be okay being vulnerable, but also be okay asking for help, because I think in those situations, folks felt as if, hey, I don't really know what's going on. But given my past experience, like I don't think it's going to be something greater than it has been before. And ultimately, as we know, that wasn't the case. And so I think it's okay to be wrong, is just admitting when you have faults, admitting when you don't know what's going on, because if you have any trepidation, if you have any concern about how you think you're going to do something, go ahead and seek for help, or try to think about it a different way. Because in a lot of situations, in hindsight, when we've done the review, when we've had the independent reviews, there's specific moments in those reviews where there was an offer made for something, or someone was given additional information, but they thought they had the correct information, and ultimately it panned out in a negative way. Good question.
In the incident, there was the issue of the Confederate monuments and people demonstrating on behalf of Southern Heritage and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And then at another level, there's the issue of nonviolent behavior versus violent behavior, violent intolerance. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering about the aftermath in terms of is there a general feeling at UVA about violent intolerant behavior? Is there a kinder and gentler a shared attitude, or is there more polarization, more, you know, hostile feelings about the ideological confrontation?
Sure. So, just to make sure I'm responding accordingly. So you're asking, have there been conversations about the difference between kind of peaceful protest versus violent protest? Is that what you're asking there? Okay. Yeah. So we've had a ton of those conversations, and a lot of them have been. I think there have been a lot of challenging conversations around that. So our dean of students has had a lot of. He's been our focal person for that, primarily because he has a background in law. But it's really explaining to students this concept of free speech, what free speech is. And the idea, I would be a little more tactful, but one of his go-tos is being a jerk or being an expletive is not illegal. And trying to help individuals understand that to limit speech that you don't agree with on one side means that you have to limit speech that you don't agree with on the other side. And their response, a lot of the students' response has been, well, our language isn't threatening, or our language doesn't incite violence. And I think some of the pushback has been, it could, right? Like that the way that people receive things is subjective. And something that you say that may not necessarily, that you don't believe is aggressive, or that you don't believe will incite violence, may be that thing for someone else. And so trying to pull the ideology out of it and try to think about it as what we're talking about here is the ability to express your thoughts freely in a manner that is safe. And that's been really challenging for some students to hear, because I think when you hear blood and soil, or when you hear Jews will not replace us, you know, the response is, well, why don't you stop them? Like, that's clearly insightful, that's clearly threatening, and that's going to lead to violence. But if we do that, then we have to limit every other speech. And it's more trying to help young people and professionals think about what is your response to this, and how can you kind of control your response and manage your response? And then for folks that are coming to you or people that you know may be impacted by this, how can you engage with them to also help them understand, like, this isn't right, and it's not, you know, it's not beneficial, it's not encouraging, it is, you know, you may label it as hateful and say that it is really divisive, but here's a better way to respond to this and a better way to manage your response that's going to keep you safe, keep you out of harm's way. Because the fact of the matter is, there's always going to be somebody there, there's oftentimes going to be somebody there who wants to be a provocateur, and often a lot of the tactics that Kessler and Spencer use are to be provocateurs. They want someone to cross that line. They're educated men, so they know, I know this is free speech. I know that I can say, hey, I hate you because of X, Y, and Z, say really, really insidious things to get under someone's skin in the hopes that that person is going to lash out, that they haven't thought about the way that they're going to manage their response or manage their emotions that's not going to elicit that kind of response. And so that's been a lot of what my conversations have been with students and a lot of the conversations I've heard. I know it's a little more intellectual than practical. It's not a very utilitarian response, but that's the approach that we've taken. And again, some of that's limited by the fact that I'm an agent of the state and that we're all agents of the state at UVA. And so we're precluded in some ways from sharing.